With this, we move to Dr. Rupamanjari Ghosh, Vice Chancellor, Shiv Nath University, Delhi NCR, and Co-Chair, FICCI Higher Education Committee, for a leadership talk on modernizing to a digital first institutions. Over to you, Dr. Rupamanjari Ghosh, and we're also joined by my colleague Sudhir Gautam. He's a resident editor and head South India APAC News Network. Over to both of you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for inviting me and for having me in this session. I have a few minutes to talk about this topic that was given to me. So allow me to share my screen. All right. So I think I'll take a few minutes to talk about this. This is a topic that was taken, and I think I heard Prabhat Ranjan a bit, and then before that, I mean, only a glimpse of that. We never rehearsed, but I think our thinking is quite similar. So let me go ahead in the next few minutes to say what I'm going to say. So first, I'm going to point out that in the higher education sector, it's not digital first. Probably the topic should be creativity first. I'll explain that. So I think this is the real task, because the call for innovation, and I'm going to define innovation in a minute, call for innovation has reached a peak. And so we need to enable this innovation first mind. So I'd like to change the focus rightfully to innovation first or creativity first, and not digital first. Let me elaborate on this further. But before that, let me say, what have we been doing? Prabhat Ranjan mentioned the tinkering labs, et cetera, et cetera. So I think the question we have been asking in this sector is that to our students, are you finding your dream job or are you creating it? And in that, I mean, of course, in Shiv Nada University, where I've been almost from the beginning, we are now 10-year-old. This is the question we have been facing. And to cut a very long story short, in 2017, when the Niti Aayog floated the Atal Incubation Mission and 10 incubators were actually funded, we were the youngest to get in there, and I walked out with the maximum money. So the model for me has been not the slogan "Make in India," which gives you a feeling of factory workers, as that's the labor force that comes out of university. I think that those days are gone because machines are going to take over. You don't need labor force to come out of universities. A 3 month or 6 months coaching can actually give you that kind of skilling. So what universities are needed is to do maybe make by India, output of innovators. And that's what I think this entire project has been all about. So where does digital thing fit in? Because that's the topic. And of course, I come from a privileged position where we are already digital ready. We had our LMS from almost day one. Coursera, of course, has been our partner for the last few years. And so it's very, there are two things that people mix up often, and I wanted to put it very straight. One is digital or tech infrastructure support for the delivery of teaching learning, for the delivery of research, teaching learning, and everything. So second is teaching learning and invention of digital technology. When you get involved in creation of digital technology, it's not just using it as a tool. So in the first round, so I'm going to talk about both and the issues that come up in that digital priority, that it's obvious that digital is a very powerful tool. Students who know how to use creative digital tools can learn and communicate more effectively. That we all of us know. And digital literacy can enable students to innovate, to make meaningful contributions, and accelerate their personal growth. Things that you can do using a tool, you don't need to waste your time developing yourself. But I think in this country, the big problem is, I'm not going to touch upon it, but if I don't mention it, it's going to be a crime, that we need to bridge the digital divide. Without that, all this talk about digitization and the priority in digitization will actually fall flat. You can't have so much of inequality in our system, because then the demographic dividend everybody's talking about will turn into a demographic nightmare. The second one is, of course, what I mentioned is not you just use of digital technology given to you, but development or creation of the digital technology. But there also there is a caveat I put in, that technologies alone will not be able to solve all societal problems. AI, for example, will be a great multiplier only when the physical solutions are there. Zero multiplied by any big number is still a zero. So you need to focus on solving the societal problems, the global problems, including sustainability today. And I'm going to talk about that. So let's take the first one, how technology enables. The first one is, you know, our education system. You know, I'm a physicist by profession, so I have the habit of quoting Einstein. But this one is a different one. Einstein said that everybody is a genius, but if you judge a fish by its ability to climb a tree, it will live its whole life believing that it's stupid. So that's our education system. In the name of fairness, we ask everybody to do the same thing, take the same exam, and then like climb the tree. So a monkey will be able to do it, but a penguin and a fish or an elephant will not be able to do it. So learning essentially is a design endeavor. One size, that is one model or one approach, does not fit all. So technology can indeed fine-tune and customize or personalize education as needed. And this is something that we need to focus on. So this is one point. Second is, of course, in the backdrop of COVID-19 pandemic, the fact that I'm meeting you online, the emphasis is also there in the national education policy on the use of technology. And that's very well received now. Digital has become a prerequisite for technical students. But what we have understood, you know, from day one, Shivnada University went online. We did not lose a single day in 2020, finished the semester on time, more or less, and graduated the batch in July last year. This year also, we have finished the semester and the year, and actually the convocation is going to happen online on 24th of July. So there are two kinds of courses. Some can be 100% online if you are capable, but some other at best 70%. The entire training of what we call hands-on experiential, some of it, there is no substitute. For example, even research to find a cure for COVID has to be done in the labs, and we don't have enough of AI or other capabilities to do it online. There are also two kinds of students. Our students are revolting. You know, they are desperate to come back to the campus, which we did earlier this year, and I'm going to open it up again. For PhD students are already on campus. So online works well for one group, the ones that have a job or other constraints, but it doesn't really work for others for the simple reason education is not about getting a certificate. Education has a whole lot of other things that go with it. It's 360-degree education. Much of it is peer learning. Much of it is experiential learning of the kind we're talking about. So I think even without COVID, what I see is that a hybrid or a blended model is yet to stay. And there's a lot of work that's to be done. So one point I want in this context for us to remember, the technology, of course, enables, but it also limits because it's in a fixed paradigm. So what most of us have been doing, most institutions I see are doing, is that they're compromising their pedagogy by the use of available technology. So I strongly urge that pedagogy should lead to the choice of technology, and available technology should not dictate the pedagogy, because then that's a failure in the higher education sector. And I think we need to talk to the edtech people enough to figure out what exactly is the pedagogy that we wish to follow. So continuing on that line, one thing that COVID-19 induced disruption has done is to lay bare the inner workings of universities for all to see. Whatever we have not gotten right pre-COVID, the pedagogy and the processes, the digital mode exposed the weaknesses more. How do we handle it? Agility, of course, is the key. And you have to keep taking feedback and innovating. And you have to learn from our peers all over the world. And I don't think a constraint like that should constrain our thinking. So we have to still think big, remember the picture pre-COVID, where we wanted to be. In that, I want to basically end this section by saying that technology will never replace great teachers, but technology in the hands of a great teacher can be transformational. So I think these two things have to go together, and that's one theme I'm going to talk about. So the second point I made, so I talked so far about technology and digital as a tool. The second one I talked about is creation of technology. So I think their creation of digital technology, there is a serious issue. And I'm going to make it a little light by quoting Peter Thiel. This is an old quote, that we wanted flying cars. Instead, we got 140 characters. Here, 140 characters referred to the length of a Twitter post at that time. So what's the point? Point is, when you want flying cars, you just are stuck with the social media algorithm. Our best minds should be engaged in science and technological developments of the physical kind, and not just improving social media algorithms. I'm not saying you should not do it, but everybody should not be going after that fact. There is a lot of talk today about liberal arts on one hand and disruptive technologies on the other. And people forget that food and energy costs have been going up. Healthcare has been highly inadequate. We experienced it recently. And climate change threats are here and now. And yes, transportation on Earth or to space, flying cars or whatever, has not become more efficient. So how do you handle that? Disruptive technologies alone will not be able to solve any of these problems. So research in basic science has been the foundation for transformational technology, and we must remember to invest in there. There are no shortcuts to excellence. So fancy digitization will not get you to excellence at all. What is hope here in the country? If you have seen the All India Survey on Higher Education 1920 that came out just now, that science recorded a 16% increase in enrollment. Engineering technology at 12.6%. So there is hope, there is a tendency, but I think we need to invest our thinking, our policy emphasis on this sector. These are the real problems in the year. And why do you need university education? Because I would like to distinguish between what I call innovation, as we understand today in terms of commercialization of technology. That can happen without systematic education. But what I am calling invention, that is accelerated by education. Inventions are primarily products of education or their applied research. So I'll not elaborate on it. We can talk later. But the real question for me is that what's the next big real invention we need to have for India and the human race? And that's what we should be focusing on. So it actually needs all these aspects together, and university education stays as important as ever. So what we have been doing, and I thought I'll share this, is promoting project-based or problem-based or a purpose-based learning, so to foster creativity, design, and innovation. And I often refer to this is to tap the potential of connecting the left brain, which is verbal, analytical, and orderly, and has been coded, to the right brain, which is visual and intuitive, which has not been coded. So if you want to keep your advantage over machines, run by AI, etc., thinking machines, then we need to somehow tap into the potential of connecting the left to the right part of the brain. One experiment we are doing is by creating a design and innovation experience center that has been set up at SNU. This is in partnership with the SOAR system. The focus areas are in engineering design, business analytics, but also predictive sciences, drug discovery and system biology analysis, and so on and so forth. So I think these are the new ways of exploiting the tools, the 3D experience that, for example, the SOAR offers, and which is also has the visual intuitive part in it. And maybe from these, the students that would come out will be able to handle the world that we are facing it. I'm going to backtrack a bit and talk about last July when the National Education Policy came out. And it says something very lofty. The aim must be for India to have an education system by 2040. That's not that far. That is second to none, with equitable access to the highest quality education for all learners, regardless of social or economic background. It talks about quality education, but what constitutes quality? In broad terms, I would say quality education should empower. An education system of quality should strive to get all the learners reach their unique and full potential. I think this is the job of higher education institutions, to make sure that their learners reach their unique and full potential, and then they enter the global society as productive citizens. So you should focus on the whole learner. You prepare them for life and not merely a certification. So that's really where National Education Policy is lofty aims are. And it says many things and sort of resonates with what we have been doing at Shivnada University, particularly, holistic multidisciplinary education, flexibility of subject sciences, inclusivity, and enabling lifelong learning. Of course, leveraging technology, autonomy within a regulatory framework, et cetera, et cetera. So the real skill that you need to impart on your students, the digital skill, is of a different kind. Again, a quote from Einstein, the value of an education in a liberal studies university like ours, it's not the learning of many facts, but the training of the mind to think something that cannot be learned from textbooks. So what is the point? Point is, you need to emphasize on creativity and critical thinking to encourage logical decision-making and innovation. So be digital ready, but before that must be creativity and innovation ready. And that's what digital would be, just a tool for you to get there. And this would be really, we should talk about the future of what problem, how education should lead to livelihood, and so on and so forth. We have been discussing this. I'll not get into the details. Some of you may have seen my writing here and there. But the basic question, will an algorithm take your job? So I don't want to copy a machine. Digitization doesn't mean you become like a digital machine. So what are humans still good for? That's higher education's moment of choice today. So I think I can list down a few things where I think humans are still good for. You have an edge over machines, and the aim of a higher education system should not be to produce what robots can do. So I think you should not be also short-sighted. If you're industry ready today, you would be jobless tomorrow. The only skill that never goes outdated is the skill of creative problem solving or critical thinking, and then leading to independent decision making. I'll not read this out. I just quoted it to say that there's an entire section on online and digital education at the NEP, but it talks about ensuring equitable use of technology, and that's very, very important. And related is faculty development, because you can't do any of this if you are not continuously investing in your faculty development. So what am I talking about? I'm talking about education without quality serves no purpose, but the very definition of educational quality and excellence perhaps needs reimagination. You need accreditation and quality assurance as the base for all institutions. Self-regulation is the key, but this definitely has digitization at the base of it. We need to actually make sure that we don't judge every institution by uniform parameters, because that makes universities risk averse. And the entire ecosystem today is geared towards being able to take risks, you know, of course, not gambling, but educated gambling, you know, educated risks. So this is, and the ultimate thing has to be research quest for new meaningful knowledge, where you combine the priorities of abstract knowledge generation and excellence and relevant research. Absolutely. And link the contributions of science, research, and innovation. I'm already done. This is my last slide. So you need resources, financial, intellectual, to enable. And the focus has to be on quality of faculty hiring, development, and empowerment. And we must take advantage of digital technology, but address equity. So digital literacy should be brought in at all levels. So I'll stop here, and you know, we'll be looking forward to our discussions.
Thank you very much, Dr. Rupamanjari Ghosh, for that visionary talk. As you rightly said, it is not about modernizing to a digital first institution, but it is to a creative first institution. You talked, how the capacity building of teaching staff needs to be, at the same time, the critical thinking and all. It's an absolute pleasure to hear you, the visionary talk. We are happy that we have education leaders like you in our country. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
There is a certificate of appreciation from us, being proudly presented to Dr. Rupamanjari Ghosh, Vice Chancellor, Shiv Nadar University, Delhi NCR, and she's also the co-chair FICCI Higher Education Committee, for her dedicated efforts and exemplary work in education. Thank you very much, Dr.
Thank you so much. Thank you.